from local medical experts, community leaders, and more.
Join us every Monday and Thursday at 9 a.m. live on Facebook and YouTube, and every afternoon at 5:06 on KSJE 90.9 FM and 103.3 FM. KSJE is supported by San Juan Regional Medical Center, here to meet your urgent and emergent medical needs, whether they are COVID-19 related or not. Medical emergencies happen when you least expect them. Whether it's a stroke, heart attack, illness, or injury, San Juan Regional Medical Center's caregivers are here to provide care to you and your loved ones. Find out more online at sanjuanregional.com. Ten minutes past 8 o'clock. It's Thursday morning, August 6th. Good morning, everybody. I'm Scott Micklin. Thank you for tuning in to KSJE 90.9 FM over the air here in San Juan County, 103.3 FM over the air in Durango, Colorado, and of course everywhere streaming from our website at ksje.com. Welcome also to our viewers who are watching this visual radio program streaming live to the KSJE YouTube channel and Facebook page. We're glad that you are with us this morning, everybody. Coming up in the next few moments, my guest today on the program, archaeologist Paul Reed, is standing by to join us from his home in Valdez, New Mexico. We'll be speaking about some issues that have come up recently in the world of archaeology and much, much more. So we're glad that you're with us for our conversation, which will start in the next few moments right here on KSJE. And then, of course, we invite you to stick around for the next hour. It is our local information program about COVID-19. Megan Cullop will be joining me here in Studio A, and we'll be talking today with Sally Marquez. She is the Executive Director of the New Mexico Activities Association. We'll be speaking about the plan for prep sports in the fall. And, of course, as we know, things are not the same this year because of COVID-19 and public health orders and all those different things. So Sally Marquez will be joining us to talk about that coming up this morning at 9 a.m. You can watch us live on YouTube and Facebook. A rebroadcast this afternoon, of course, on KSJE Radio at 5:06 p.m. And also today on the program, we're speaking with Jenny Lee Ryan from the Farmington Public Library about some of their offerings during this lockdown and the health orders at the library. Still able to offer some programming and, of course, some great resources there. Mick Hess at 9 a.m. is going to take us roving with the arts. He is playing selections from Brahms this morning on the program, so we hope you'll join him on the radio at 9 for that this morning. Don't forget, of course, you can also connect with us on Twitter and on Instagram, in addition to our Facebook and YouTube platforms. And let's check the weather forecast. Things have become sunny and mild during the day. Clear and cool overnight is the weather words for the next few days. 93 and sunshine today in Farmington, clear and 58 overnight. Sunny and 92 on Friday. It'll be 94 on Saturday, 93 and sunshine on Sunday, 94 and sunny on Monday. And overnight lows, as you can see, right around 60 degrees. Well, let me turn to my guest, who is here with us this morning, as I mentioned, from his home in Valdez, New Mexico. That is Paul Reed, local archaeologist with Archaeology Southwest and Salmon Ruins. Paul, good morning.
Morning, Scott. Glad to be back on with you.
Good to see you, and thank you for joining us yet again. And a number of topics to kind of talk about this morning, and there are some articles that I sent you and some that you sent me, so we could talk about all of them this morning. And let's begin maybe with the one I sent you a few weeks ago, which was about some work being done in Mexico about with some archaeologists and kind of changing the timelines a little bit about what we thought we knew.
Right, right, and this is a great topic, and one that we've talked about on the show a few times, which is, you know, how early is the earliest evidence that we have for folks living in North or South America?
Right,
and this one is particularly interesting, and it's very early. So the archaeologists working down there in a place called Chiquihuit Cave, which is way high up in the mountains in Mexico, almost at 9,000 feet. They've got some tools and a context that they've dated to right around 30,000 years ago. So that's quite a bit older than, you know, what we've been talking about for a few decades now.
Right, and I'll share the story that I sent you from NBC News, and it kind of talks a little bit about that, showing some photos so viewers that are watching can kind of see what we're talking about just a little bit. But this is kind of goes along with what you've told me over and over again, that we think we know what's going on. We think we have a narrative and a story, but yet all that archaeology is and science in general is that we accept new evidence and prove it and try to prove it wrong or disprove or accept it and move on from there, right?
Right. And, you know, and particularly in the field of archaeology, we're not sure what the next site that someone might investigate is going to turn up. Now, this one has been met with sort of a mix of some folks saying, yeah, that could work, and others, you know, who are more in favor of what we've talked about on the show before is kind of a Clovis first, you know, this horizon at about 13,000 years ago, saying, no, this, you know, the data aren't that solid. So, you know, but I think this is a very intriguing find, and I think that certainly more work, as they continue to do more work, you know, they'll either get more that verifies it, or, you know, perhaps they won't ultimately be able to sustain the idea that it's that early. But, you know, this has been chipping away at what we've talked about before, which is this notion that, you know, Clovis is not the first well-dated, you know, horizon is the way we talk about it in archaeology, but really the presence of people in North and South America, that we do have a number of sites now that are pushing this back to 15,000 to 20,000, this one going perhaps back to 30,000. So, you know, and there's no particular reason why folks couldn't have made the journey, you know, from Northeast Asia across to the New World, you know, at this time. What we've sort of been stuck with is this idea that, you know, the glaciers had to retreat, you know, which didn't happen until around 14,000 years ago, to create what we've talked about as the ice-free corridor for folks to migrate through on the land. But what folks have been talking about for a while, too, archaeologists, is more of a migration down the coastline. So people who use small boats, who are much more focused on shellfish and, you know, aquatic resources, certainly would have been able to come over and to exploit, hunt and fish up and down those shorelines quite a bit earlier. So, you know, I think this is mostly about sort of broadening our perspective on it and, you know, being willing to look at the new evidence and certainly to look at it critically, but right, not just absolutely put our feet down and say, you know, this is what happened.
Sure.
That's not how we do science. The problem is people's egos get tied up in these things, and if you're one of these people who's said for decades that this is, you know, your version of the truth, then it's sometimes hard to look at things differently. But what I've come to, certainly in, you know, 30 plus years doing this myself, is we're looking for different aspects of that truth. And, you know, we're really looking for different narratives that help us understand the past. And, you know, we're not really seeking one single truth or anything. At least I'm not anymore, and I think a lot of us aren't. I think we understand that the past is very complicated.
Right, which is understandable, but also a little bit frustrating at times as well. And the location of this discovery, Paul Reed, I mean, we're showing pictures of the kind of the cave complex that looks like where these folks are working and things along that line. Does that add to or detract from the objects that were found there? Is that something? Obviously, it all goes into the record, right?
Right. Well, it is one of the things that, you know, one of the archaeologists who is very skeptical of these early sites has wondered about is, like, why is this location so high up in the mountains, and what's the advantage of living at almost 9,000 feet? But, you know, the archaeologists doing the work down there, who are from Zapotecas University, note that, you know, this cave, this particular locale, was used for thousands of years, and that's nothing unusual at all. You know, we have sites all across the world where people, you know, even going way back into our early, you know, development as people and back into Neanderthal, you know, times, and those folks, people use the same locales for thousands, even tens of thousands of years, because they're favorable spots where, you know, they can get refuge from predators or perhaps other groups in the area that they're not friendly with, and they can get access to a variety of different resources. So, you know, so I think the remote location here is, you know, is interesting, but it certainly isn't something that we would say, oh yeah, well, this kind of disqualifies the site in any way.
Right.
The other interesting thing with this hypothesis, of course, is that if we're talking about people moving down basically the west coast of both North Central and South America at different points, a lot of those sites are underwater now because at various points with the glaciers tying up lots of the surface water and ice, the water basically retreats. And this, of course, is the land bridge idea, you know, for the area between Siberia and what's now Alaska and Canada, right, where that water gets tied up in glaciers. And essentially you have not super dry land, but you have sort of marshy, swampy land that people could have come across, you know, as they work their way down the coast. So when the glaciers melted and we got out of the last glacial period, roughly 10,000-ish years ago, then the water came back and would have flooded a lot of these sites. So, you know, and of course we're seeing this with climate change today when some of these lakes have been drying up in different parts around the world. They've revealed lots and lots of sites. So, you know, it's been somewhat of a benefit, you know, in sort of an ironic way. And if we look at, like, the Iceman, I think we talked about him briefly on an earlier show, but the man found in the Alps, he was found because of snow melts and the retreat of the snow fields and the glaciers there. And, of course, he was a very well-preserved fellow from several thousand years ago. So anyway, you know, as different areas get exposed, then we see more of these sites. So, yeah, I think this is a really interesting location. And, you know, these archaeologists, as I understand it now from reading the article and digging a little deeper, are going to do continued work in this area. So, you know, they may well find other sites that fit into this time period and continue to support this. So, you know, and of course, these things make a big splash.
Sure.
So,
well, got my attention.
Yeah, yeah, and I'm glad it did, Scott. And when that happens, you know, people get excited if they, you know, if they're interested in this research. But then, sort of, the old guard will start to, you know, pull in and talk to each other and say, well, I don't know, you know, we're skeptical of this particular find. And, you know, as we've talked many, many times, that's fine because this whole process of doing archaeological science, that's how we advance it. You know, we make findings, we try to do the best work we can, we study the data, we publish papers. So it will be interesting in the months to come when this comes out. And this was not a huge article, a couple of articles in the journal Nature. So if a larger report, what we call a monograph, comes out with more data, then that'll give, you know, the folks a lot of things to chew on, right?
Right, sure.
And try and sort out at least this version of this narrative, this little bit of the truth.
Right, that's true. Well, and as you've talked to us before, Paul Reed, you've mentioned that maybe some of your colleagues maybe enjoy looking at discoveries like this and maybe trying to prove them right or wrong and really try to see if they hold up to scrutiny. And that's what this process is all about, I suppose, right?
Yeah, it absolutely is. And, you know, this is why we do the work. So obviously none of us were there 30,000 years ago. So we basically try and tell a good story.
Sure.
And support it with what we've learned and the data that we have. And, you know, a lot of times someone else comes along and they don't particularly like your story. So, and you get into that debate and, you know, but that's all right. That's why we're doing this stuff. We're ultimately seeking greater knowledge about the past of humanity. And there are, you know, as we've discussed, many, many ways to crack that nut to get to that point of understanding.
Right. And I would think a lot of your colleagues would want their discoveries to be maybe either enhanced or proved or disproved. If somebody has some other evidence, then that's how it should be. And that's a transparent way of moving things forward.
Right. Occasionally, you know, we'll have folks who are avocationalists who aren't full-time professionals who make findings. And I've certainly, you know, encountered some folks who I know who are sometimes a little confused and perhaps even hurt by the amount of scrutiny and the criticism. But, you know, that's just kind of the way of the world. So it's good to be thick-skinned, probably for most of our endeavors.
That's true. Very true. And you mentioned just the location about this discovery, and I just wanted to bring up a point maybe locally, and you tell me if I'm right or wrong, but I mean, couldn't we draw, I know there are different eras of history, but can we draw a parallel to the locations of some of the sites we have here in the Four Corners? I'm thinking specifically Mesa Verde about, you know, who would build a house or live on inside of a cliff or on the side of a cliff, and those types of things were probably for defensive purposes, and I know there's a lot of research about that location, right, about why they were living in those places.
Right, right. And that's the thing that we really see across time and space on planet Earth for humans, and even, you know, our non-human but close cousins like Neanderthals, the Denisovans, and others, is these caves, rock shelters, these very sheltered environments are highly favored because they keep you out of the elements, they keep you out of the cold, the heat, the rain, the snow, and these are persistent places on our landscapes. And right, with the case of the amazing sites that we have just up north at Mesa Verde, you know, these places then became the focal points of very large pueblos that were built into them, you know, and mostly in the case up north and other parts across the Southwest after 1200 or even 1220. So, and at that point, yeah, it does seem like folks were very interested in having large dwellings in protected places, even if they weren't the most convenient. So, you know, and that sort of takes us back to the cave down in Mexico and the archaeologists, you know, wondering, well, why is this a favored location? Well, maybe it's favored because it is kind of tucked away. And you have a spot that gives you that buffer of, you know, some protection from predators and from your neighbors, as well as just, you know, the weather and everything else.
True. Very true. My guest this morning, local archaeologist Paul Reed, is joining me today from his home in Valdez, New Mexico. We are talking about, first of all, a discovery of some artifacts in the mountains in Mexico, which tends to maybe move the timeline of human arrival here in Central and North America a little bit earlier than previously thought. Also, I want to ask you a bit about some other articles, Paul Reed, about this repatriation, if you will, of some Native American artifacts. It's been an ongoing discussion. I know you and I have had this before, but specifically this shield from the Acoma Pueblo that was returned from, of all places, France. And the story of how it got there is kind of fascinating, and the story of how it got back to the Pueblo, I think, is fascinating as well, but it kind of highlights an even broader issue. But let's talk about the shield at first. Talk to us how that's significant to the Acoma people, is it not?
Yeah, this is one of their most significant ceremonial items, so much so that they're not publishing pictures of it. I think some came out in an earlier article a couple of years ago. But, you know, this goes back decades to when the shield was came out of Acoma Pueblo through a less than legal process that, you know, is somewhat unclear, but got right into the hands of collectors. And, you know, one of the things that we see worldwide is that, you know, particularly in Europe, European collectors really value Native American artifacts and art. And, you know, while we can certainly look at that and appreciate their respect for the art and their desire to see it preserved and protected, you know, we get into some murky areas because many of these items are of great ceremonial importance to different tribes. And what we have in America, and we've talked about this on the show before briefly, but we have a law called the Native American Grave Repatriation and Protection Act, or NAGPRA for short. This allows tribes in America who are federally recognized to go to museums and identify objects that are not just individual objects, pieces of pottery that might have belonged to someone, but actual objects of, the term is, cultural patrimony, so intimately related to the tribe's oral history or to a specific clan or group's history, and then they can petition the museum to have those returns through this federal law, and the museums are required to do this. And so this law was passed in 1990, and as part of it, museums were required to inventory all these objects, as well as any human remains, because as we know, museums for centuries, decades and centuries, have held, you know, individual human remains from different tribes, and, you know, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of people. So the law was designed to redress that issue, and I think has been pretty successful. The other part of that is items of cultural patrimony, but of course these laws don't apply to other countries, so that makes it particularly tricky. So Acoma became aware of this shield, this particular shield that was for sale at an auction house, and they, through, you know, the governors at the time, Fred Bio, contacted the State Department, went through our state and then the U.S. State Department, and was able to get in touch with the owners in France and get the auction delayed. And then there was another issue, and they tried to put it up for sale again. So it was this lengthy, multi-year negotiation and conversation that eventually did result in the auction house setting it aside, and the person who owned it not asking for any financial compensation from the tribes, and that's something that the tribes feel pretty strongly about, that they shouldn't have to buy back their own items of cultural patrimony.
Right.
And the object was ultimately returned through, you know, this really long multi-year process that involved a whole lot of conversations and, you know, two different countries at the highest levels. So yeah, just a real complicated process. You know, and this highlights again the unfortunately the real strong market for Native American goods that, you know, and objects of art that sometimes are acquired under real sort of shady circumstances.
Sure, we're sharing the story that you shared with me, Paul Reed, from the High Country News, I believe it is, and they came right out in the headline and said it was stolen from the tribe. But as you mentioned, it may be a little muddy about just how it got in to leave the Pueblo, but how it got over to France and now to try to get it back. And I imagine this is one story of maybe many repeated throughout history, right, and different tribes that are trying to get back some of their historic, sacred artifacts, and they mean a great deal to these Native people.
Right. You know, another prominent example is the Hopi tribe in Arizona, and, you know, several ceremonial masks that were very important to the tribe that also were sold by folks who didn't have the authority to at earlier points in time, and then ended up in collections and ultimately ended up at, you know, it might be the same auction house or a similar one in France. And then the Hopi tribe petitioning the auction house and getting the French government, the State Department involved in trying to get those items back. So it is really an intersection and really a collision between this notion of collecting other people's cultural property and then the originating group's rights to hold their own property. You know, and it's they talk about, you know, this also connects to what the Nazis did in all across Europe in looting these art collections and then the real lengthy process, decades now, of getting those items back to proper owners and to the countries of origin. You know, and really similar things like, you know, the work that the British Museum sponsored in Egypt when, you know, the pyramids came under a whole lot of scrutiny and excavation. So lots and lots of items taken out and ending up in different museums worldwide. And the Egyptian government now and people saying, hey, we want these things back. So the problem is, you know, these things end up being greatly valued in the art world. So things having tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands, even millions of dollars of value attached to them, and people not wanting to give them back. This right. was a big issue in the States, here in the States, with, you know, the NAGPRA law and as it was being implemented, because museums held objects that had become greatly valued through time. You know, one example is the Zuni, the so-called Zuni war gods, which were carved wooden objects that need to exist in shrines around different places on Zuni land and are very important to their religion and cosmology. Well, these items were stolen by anthropologists in some cases early on, sold out, and, you know, several of them ended up in the Denver Museum of Science and Nature and were valued at, you know, tens of thousands of dollars. So Zuni actually went through a process before the NAGPRA legislation was put in place in 1990. So they were working in the 70s and 80s to get these items returned and sort of going through the process of showing the museum curators and their boards that these are items of great importance to us. And, you know, that helped drive, of course, the passage of the repatriation law in 1990. But yeah, a real lengthy process for tribes to get back items that are really important to them. And, you know, and the interesting thing to me, looking at it from my perspective at this point, having done this archaeology and some museum work for 30 years, the museums are very resistant to deaccessioning, is the term they use, and sort of letting these items go from their collections, even after tribes had, you know, in many cases, thoroughly demonstrated that the objects are theirs, that they're communal property, and that they fall under, you know, this specific piece of federal law. But, you know, sort of the right of the collector and the museums as collectors, you know, has been very difficult to overcome for a lot of the groups.
Sure, sure. And another article from the High Country News, again, that you shared in the headline, Trading in Native Artifacts Does Real Harm. And it talks about this federal law, but says that it's incomplete and ineffective when it comes to protecting indigenous lands from looting, and that's probably an issue that you deal with when you're out in the field, right? Is coming across sites maybe that have been discovered and disturbed, and that doesn't leave you with much to work with if it's been pawed through.
Right. So we have a, you know, before things become artifacts and identified in museums or collections, you know, which would potentially invoke the NAGPRA law, we have a law called the Archaeological Resources Protection Act of 1979. That was designed specifically to address the problem of widespread looting because, right, not only is it the stuff, you know, the items, the special items that are already in collections and that collectors pass around between each other, but it's the notion of going to sites that are undisturbed potentially or not highly disturbed and, you know, digging up new items without doing it, you know, through the process that we do in archaeology at least, and then pulling those out and then claiming they're from private land, which wouldn't technically be illegal, but a lot of times people loot on public lands and then forge documents to say, oh, it's from this ranch, and, you know, then they create a trail that says this, I legally collected this because I had landowner permission. And in some cases, the landowners do just allow collectors to come in. I think, you know, we've had some impact with getting landowners to understand that maybe that isn't the best process. But a lot of times people just want to make a buck. You know, the other issue is we've had it with the last couple of decades and some of our drug-related problems is people who are drug addicts have taken this avenue to raise money, literally. So they'll go out to places and look, dig for pots and other items just simply to sell as rapidly as they can. And of course that leads, has led to a lot of damage. But anyway, this Archaeological Resources Protection Act, or ARPA, does provide some, you know, law enforcement teeth, if you will, to allow people who are caught digging to then be prosecuted under the law and potentially, you know, be fined or serve jail time. It's difficult, though, because a lot of times district attorneys aren't interested in pursuing these. They're not seen as really major crimes. And then even if they get into a court proceeding and, you know, and there's a guilty verdict, judges are very reluctant to sentence people under those laws. So without a lot of enforcement, that makes it difficult. So a lot of the folks who work on this mostly have tried to take the education angle and just, you know, try to reinforce to people that, you know, we're all interested at some level in these pieces of the past, but the best way to enjoy them really is to leave them out on the landscape. If you find pieces of pottery or stone tools, projectile points, arrowheads, look at them, photograph them, enjoy them, but leave them in place so that they can stay with the sites where they originally were. And certainly people should understand that digging in any piece of property is illegal without permission. You know, and even on our public lands with you know, the concerns that have come to us from the various tribes, not many agencies now want to permit archaeological work without, you know, really good reasons to do that, like imminent destruction through construction projects or the like.
Right.
You know, so some of that awareness is coming on. But yeah, once the objects go into some sort of a collection, then potentially the NAGPRA law could come into play. But for things that are totally privately held, you know, that's a tricky road. You know, things come up for sale on eBay occasionally, you know, ancient artifacts. And so there are folks who monitor those and they come up, they contact the sellers and try and talk about different processes. But, you know, the whole black market, illicit market in art, you know, especially what people consider ancient or primitive art, you know, bad terms in my mind, but the primitive part, but just these pieces of art and culture from the past, you know, this is unfortunately big business. So, and there's not enough law enforcement that's directed to protecting these places. Plus, you know, the other issue basically, and especially in New Mexico, is we're a small state with, you know, just over 2 million people, and we're the fifth largest state. So we have really vast spaces, empty spaces, where, you know, it's pretty easy to slip into some area if you're aware of a site and potentially do a lot of damage.
Right. True. You can't have eyes and ears everywhere. That's very true. Well, Paul, we are just about out of time, but again, it's been a fascinating conversation, as it always is, with you about your field and the work that you and your colleagues are doing. So thank you very much.
Well, Scott, and I've enjoyed it a lot, as always. And we'll have more to speak of in the future.
We definitely will. We'll catch up with you again in about a month.
Sounds great.
All right. Thank you. That is Paul Reed from Archaeology Southwest and Salmon Ruins, my guest here on KSJE. Back with more in just a moment, everybody. The time right now is 8:41.
A federal judge mourning